In contemporary ordinary language, people use the term sublime to express something like a more intense form of beauty or an especially marvelous experience. While this is not necessarily incorrect, in aesthetics the sublime has a specific and technical meaning, and we can do better both in speaking and writing with greater precision if we will observe the distinctions already incorporated into our existing vocabulary. Immanuel Kant, who put almost nothing simply or clearly, did manage to frame the distinction between the beautiful and the sublime with wonderful clarity and concision, in six words no less. The beautiful charms, the sublime moves. In other words, if you are charmed by something attractive, you have experienced the beautiful. But if you are actually moved by something you have encountered, then you have experienced the sublime. One doesn't merely notice or encounter the sublime, one feels the sublime. Kant distinguished three parts of the sublime: the noble sublime, the terrifying sublime, and the splendid sublime. The noble sublime is the sort of thing that Winckelmann famously said of Greek sculpture, edel Einfalt und stille Größe, that is to say, noble simplicity and quiet grandeur. This was a certain Hellenistic ideal, especially admired during the Enlightenment, and still present to a certain extent in the 19th century in the form of Matthew Arnold's emphasis on sweetness and light as a constituent of culture. But civilization has seen a lot of water under the bridge since then, turbulent and muddy waters, I might add. While we might not respond so powerfully to classical Greek sculpture today, a proper education of one's taste can bring one to the point of responding viscerally to such beauty. The noble sublime is also embodied, so far as my experience extends, in some of the great gardens of Kyoto. Unlike the noble sublime, the terrifying sublime is very timely, and I am sure that anyone listening to this has experienced what it is like to respond viscerally and emotionally to a terrifying experience. One is moved by such experiences, even if being moved is not an especially pleasant thing. One thinks of, for example, a typical contemporary horror film as an example of the terrifying sublime, if it is a successful horror film and if one responds to it. The splendid sublime, however, is formulated in parallel to the formulations for the noble sublime and the terrible sublime, but it is distinct. In short, the splendid sublime is to be moved by beauty, to respond viscerally to beauty. The splendid sublime is a complex experience insofar as it involves both the beautiful and the sublime at once. Perhaps it comes to us in two stages, first noticing a beauty that charms, and then being moved by it as the experience cascades into something greater. But it is just as possible, for example, that one might round a corner and be struck in an instant by a view that is something no camera can quite capture. One suddenly draws in one's breath, and then one realizes one's entire being has responded to the sight. With this sketch of aesthetic theory, then, you will understand what I mean when I say that Portland this fall has embodied the splendid sublime. Some of the past few days have been among the most beautiful fall days I have ever seen. The sky has been completely clear, the sun has been shining brightly, but not with the intensity of summer. The trees have lost half or more of their leaves, but there are many trees, leaves still in the trees and many covering the ground. When a few days ago I went for a walk in the Hoyt Arboretum, I took a number of pictures that I show here. And last, a few nights ago, couldn't have been a more perfect Halloween evening than the crisp, clear air and the full moon lighting the leaf litter quietly covering the ground. So, that was Autumn's splendid sublime.